Having done a lot of work for several years, I concluded that the most important Greek that has ever come through Boston is that guy that we call Michael Anagnos, who was from Epirus. I have it here on the front page, that's why I put him on the front page here on my little brochure. 3 or 4 years ago, do you have one?
No.
What?
They're free of charge.
So, 4 or 5 years ago, I was in his birth village, Papigo, where the road actually ends. Yeah, you can't, you have to make a U-turn and go back. I don't know what they do there in the winter, but that's what it is. So I go to a school that was have been turned into a little museum for the village, and I read that one of its members had distinguished himself abroad, that his name was Michalis Anagnostopoulos, or Mike Anagnos, who was for 30 years head of the Perkins School of the Blind in Watertown, which is next to where I live. I said, what the heck is this? How come I've never heard of this guy before? So I took it upon myself to learn a lot about this guy. So he's covered regularly by the Globe, by the Herald, all the papers of his era. He was quite a guy. He met the greatest of all Greek Philhellenes, Samuel Gridley Howe, who happens also to come from Boston. They met as he was, Howe came to Greece to distribute money for the Cretan Revolution in the mid to late 1800s. And he asked him to help out in the distribution of the money. He liked Anagnos' work so much, he invited him to come to the States to help him with the Perkins School and to also teach Greek, primarily to his daughter, whom he eventually married. In 1876, when Samuel Gridley Howe dies, the trustees of the institution appoint Michael Anagnos as the director of the school. So that's how he arrived at that post. That's our guy. Another person of major importance for Boston was somebody who had been born in Hydra. His parents, his whole family was devastated by the plague, and went to live with an uncle of his in Malta, where he met, his name was Fotios Kavassalis, and there he meets an American missionary whose name was the Reverend Pliny, P-L-Y-N-E, Fisk, F-I-S-K. And the Reverend Fisk asks his uncle if it would be possible for him to take young Fotios back to America to study. That's exactly what happened. And in gratitude, Fotios Kavassalis changed his name, his last name, to Fisk. So today he's known as Fotios Fisk, F-I-S-K. Fotios studied theology and became a chaplain of the American Navy for 40 years. Very well respected. But here is the thing about him. He was very much involved with women's rights and the rights of slaves. He never married, never had any kids. All the money he made went to these causes, primarily abolitionist causes. Whenever he heard that in the South, for example, so-and-so was struggling, he would send money or he would go there himself to support this group or that group, which is fascinating for 1880s, okay, for somebody to put in this kind of money. But he was, and as you can see from his picture, which is on page two, he's a very meek, quiet, non-threatening guy. So that's Fotios Fisk. Very well respected, and then left his property again to when he died to these causes. A few years later, he succeeded by a legend at Harvard, Evangelinos Apostolidis Sophocles, who was born in Tsangarada in Pelion. He studied with an uncle of his in St. Catherine's Monastery, and then eventually came to America, and he started teaching as a TA at Harvard until he impressed his people, his superiors, supervisors so much that they eventually made him a professor, and he was a professor there from, I don't know how many years, many years, 30, 40 years. He was a legend. He is an interesting guy, another guy who never got married. And in his house in Cambridge, we know the address, I haven't been to visit it, he had a backyard with chickens. And he gave to his chickens the names of his friends. I don't know, but that's our guy, okay? Evangelinos Apostolidis Sophocles, 1814 to 1883. He attended Amherst College in 1828. In fact, many of the people we're talking about now have attended Amherst. I don't know what the connection was, but many of those who ended up teaching had attended Amherst College. And if you check the records of graduation, et cetera, they still, we have their names, along with a brief description about what these people accomplished while at Amherst. So that was one of them. And he became a Harvard professor in 1854. He has written many books. He's a philanthropist, a well-known philanthropist. He left all his books to the Harvard Library. And he was a recluse, and the students adored him. In fact, one of them did, is it a play called The Teacher or something? I haven't read it, but they say it's one of his students wrote that. They were. John Calivergos Zachos, 1820-1898. He was brought here by Samuel Gridley Howe as one of the orphan kids. And studied at Amherst College, and became a Unitarian minister. He was assigned to West Newton, and I live in Newton, so all of a sudden I'm finding about some Greek who was a Unitarian minister in the 1860s, West Newton. Okay, what else am I gonna see? Fine. So he then devoted his life, first of all, to abolitionism, but also to phonetic use of typing. He's the inventor of stenography and stenotyping, you know, all these machines that people use in courts, etc. Now, here is one of my favorites. In my search for journalism history, through what John correctly described as the Boston Journalism Trail. In case you don't know, this is the birthplace of American journalism. Okay? And a few blocks from, let's say, the consular office downtown is where the first American papers appeared. So I was very proud to discover that, and also the fact that the first Jewish newspaper was printed here, the first Methodist newspaper was printed here, etc., etc. And all of a sudden I'm finding out that the first Greek newspaper in America was published here. I was in seven heaven, as you can imagine. Okay. The paper was published on March 25th, 1892, by Constantine Fasularidis from Nisiros. So I was very excited. I called everywhere. I called the librarians in charge. I called their relatives in charge. I called the historical societies, anybody I could find. I called churches. I called the patriarchate, because Fasularidis had studied in the Megali to Giannis Holi. And I said, maybe he sent a copy proudly to his teachers. They did not have anything. So, up to today, I have not been able to unearth a copy of that.